So this is a difficult session, post-lunch session. I'll try to keep you awake and entertained. Let's see if I succeed. So I'm one of the pain consultants at James Cook. And so let's see, can we advance? Yes, we can. Yeah. So pain management in athletes, it is a difficult topic. Sports injury is common. One of my research nurses says any exercise is bad for health because you injure yourself. So pain is a normal physiological accompaniment of any injury with sports. Definition of pain, you probably all know that it is an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience that is associated with actual or potential tissue damage or described in terms of such damage. So this is a typical definition from International Association for Study of Pain. But pain in ordinary people and pain in athletes, there is slight difference into how people perceive that pain. Rather than fearing or avoiding pain, athletes may learn to live with this pain as a consequence of their pain. It is a requirement for many sports that they will injure themselves and they will suffer because of those injuries. It's a bit like the soldiers, except they don't have the post-traumatic stress disorder that goes with in the soldiers. Psychologically, you know, these athletes will feel that if they complain about their pain, it is a weakness in them. Coaches think that it is a weakness, and that's why a lot of athletes will try to hide their pain and keep on working with their exercises, their repetitive strain injuries, they keep on happening. They also learn to live through this pain process by adapting their lifestyle, adapting their training, avoiding few things. So sometimes there is a normalization and even necessity of the pain in sports may encourage them to develop their own strategies to ignore the pain and continue with the sporting activity. The sports psychology literature suggests that strategies such as association and dissociation are widely used in cognitive strategies in sport, particularly with endurance sports. And because of all this, they have greater tolerance for pain than sedentary individuals like me. Primary goal of the treatment in these athletes are rapid return to their play, prevention of recurrence of injury, and prolonging their professional career. So different kind of pains these people are going to experience. One is acute pain, which is generally described as pain up to 6 weeks following their injury. We can classify subacute pain, which can be 6 to 12 weeks after their injury, and chronic, which is more than 3 to 6 months after injury or beyond a normal tissue healing period for that injury. Now, it's a vast topic, pain management in athletes, and what I'm not going to cover, that I'm going to tell you first. I'm not going to cover acute pain because, you know, a lot of it is managed by physiotherapists and rehabilitation therapists with different strategies that go on, along with analgesics. So I'm going to cover as the last topic in my analgesic management, drug management. I'm not going to cover CRPS. It is a lecture on its own. Sport-specific injuries, it's too difficult for me to cover. Rehabilitation, you will have some lectures. Prolotherapy, platelet-rich plasma therapy, low-level laser therapy, TENS, acupuncture manipulations, and other strategies I'm not going to cover in this half an hour. So what am I going to cover with? So some of the things which you did not have on the topic today. So cervical spine injuries. And again, I'm not going to cover traumatic fractures, paraparesis, and quadriparesis because there is no pain management, certainly in the initial years or initial months following injuries. So what I'm going to cover is where I can make a difference to the athlete's life and get them back into their sporting activities. So what is the prevalence of cervical spine injuries? They commonly occur in athletes who are younger than 30 years. They differ depending on the country and what is the favorite sports in that country. In US, it is American football, wrestling, gymnastics. In Europe, rugby. In Canada, ice hockey. In a retrospective study of about 3,000 athletes who attended the NFL between 2003 to 2011, who reported that a diagnosis of cervical spine disorder, pathology or injury had been made in about 5% of athletes. So not a huge number. But what are the commonest diagnoses in these people? cervical spondylosis, cervical stenosis, either congenital, acquired, or combination of both, and cervical herniated disc. And again, this is various strategies. You heard of stinger or burner kind of injury. This is common where people get axial force applied to their neck, and then they get transient neuropathic pain like symptoms in their upper extremity in one or two dermatomal distribution. And what is the incidence of this? So about 2 per 10,000 athlete exposure. Most stingers are reported during in competition phases and some in pre-season. The time loss generally is less than 24 hours in about 60% of the athletes. So they recover spontaneously quite quickly. But still there are about 40% people who do not recover quickly. One in five of these athletes will have recurrent stingers. And these most stingers were due to player contact in 93% of the cases, particularly while tackling or blocking. And they occurred due to defensive end line blockers in about 25% and offensive linemen in about another quarter of the patients. I have also seen this in professional boxers, and in fact I have treated some professional boxers who had this stinger kind of or burner kind of injury to their spine. So what are the symptoms? There is transient episode of burning, shooting, electrical shock-like pain, paresthesia, dysesthesia, radiating down one upper extremity, so it is unilateral, after an acute event, typically involving significant contact to the head or the shoulder. Pain and sensory symptoms can be accompanied by varying degrees of weakness. Even a quadriparesis has been reported, but which is transient and it recovers very, very quickly. The symptoms are usually resolve spontaneously over 24 hours to 6 weeks. Sometimes they can continue beyond that period. Very rarely, stingers can result in permanent neurological deficit or become a recurrent problem that may ultimately limit the athlete's career in that particular sport. Pathophysiology is unclear. Tensile injuries may result in traction to either cervical nerve root or brachial plexus due to rapid lateral flexion of the neck to the contralateral side of the injury and or depression of the ipsilateral shoulder. If they have got pre-existing neural foraminal stenosis or cervical spinal cord stenosis, and then that compressive mechanism may injure the nerve root in the neural foramen. There could be whiplash kind of injury, rapid extension, lateral flexion to the ipsilateral side of the symptoms, or there could be injury to the brachial plexus. Now there is a lot of confusion whether it is a brachial plexus injury or a cervical stinger or burn. But brachial plexus is quite resilient, you know, it is an elastic structure, and injuring brachial plexus apart outside motorbike accidents is not common in these sporting injuries. Controversy about exact location of the injury, and there it may be difficult to sort this out in many cases, and you just need to keep on investigating them and treat them accordingly. Recurrent stingers in athletes with spinal canal stenosis and neural foraminal stenosis, so it will not happen generally unless they have pre-existing problem. Otherwise, it is just one-off phenomenon. Stingers are associated with, so we covered that. Typically, C5-6 nerve symptoms. There is normal neurological examination in these patients. They do not have any weakness or a sensory deficit on clinical examination. Spurling test may be provocative of their pain in about 70% of the cohort. The athletes generally has full pain-free cervical neck range of movements. There is no compromise in range of movement. There is no tenderness to palpation. And generally, the investigations are to rule out for any other injuries. So you can do plain radiographs, flexion extension views, MRI, CT scan with or without myelography. It may demonstrate their pre-existing neural foraminal stenosis if it is present. When these people had MRI, about half of them had some incidence of cervical spinal canal stenosis, and about 87% incidence of degenerative disc disease was present in this young population. EMG nerve conduction studies will be normal, but you only order them if somebody is complaining of prolonged weakness to rule out other injuries or brachial plexus injury. Treatment of recurrent stingers or where symptoms do not settle down quickly could be in the form of cervical nerve root blocks combined with facet joint injections or a cervical epidural. And I've certainly got a couple of professional boxers back into playing. They come to me, they had injury during their practice session. They have a match coming up in 3 days, 5 days time. You do an injection and generally they have been able to play their sport. If it doesn't settle down, you can also rapidly titrate antineuropathic pain medications such as gabapentin, pregabalin, till the symptoms settle down, and then you can wean them off those medication. So that was about cervical spine injury. Low back pain. Again, there is a quite high incidence. About 80% of us will experience back pain at least once in our lifetime, and the incidence in professional athletes is similar, in fact slightly higher. So lifetime incidence in, these figures are in athletes, professional athletes, this is in normal population, sedentary population. So the incidence of low back pain is reasonably high in this population. But how we respond to the low back pain and how we treat this back pain is again similar to any other normal human being or patient. So athletes who go into fear avoidance model, they blame their sport, their dangerous sport, they blame their vulnerable body, they avoid excessive load while they are in pain. There are systemic factors which don't get considered, and then they eventually have reduced fitness, reduced performance, and vulnerability for further injuries, pain, and basically end of career. However, people who are resilient, they believe that the sport is not dangerous, they are sore but not vulnerable, they maintain their load as much as possible, they consider systemic factors, they maintain their fitness, maintain their performance, and they're resilient to further injury and further pain. Low back pain intensity among the lowest is higher during their intense training period. Highly active teenagers are more likely to develop back pain in the future. These studies either did not always examine how meaningful or disabling the low back pain was. Being consistently active is associated with less pain and injury as long as the rate of increase in their activity is managed appropriately. And other relevant factors such as sleep, mood, relationships is also addressed. And this is where team working comes into picture. Lumbar strain is type of most common low back pain injury, which will happen to about 70% of the athletes. Brief period of rest for 1 to 2 days, followed by physical rehabilitation, will sort out most of these patients. In cases of severe muscle spasms, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs along with muscle relaxants can be given for a short duration. Once patient is relatively pain-free, physical rehabilitation begins, which will include stretching, strengthening, and other relevant muscle exercises. So what is the evidence? So there was a systemic review of 43 randomized controlled trials. They found moderate evidence for SMT being more effective than in short-term management of acute low back pain compared with mobilization, but not in chronic back pain. Indications for selective nerve root blocks and epidural steroid injections in low back patients was purely for lumbar disc herniation along with annular tear with or without radiculopathy. If they do not have that, then just systemic manipulation gentle manipulation of their spine should sort them out. How about lumbar disc herniations? So about 90% of the players respond well to non-operative treatment, and most of the patients will return to their sporting activities within 6 weeks of the onset of their sciatica. Non-operative treatments are again standard: physical therapy, epidural steroid injections, and modification of their activities for a short while. What is the evidence for steroid injections in athletes? So in this particular study, 32 competitive athletes with symptomatic lumbar disc herniation with radiculopathy were present. Each athlete was managed by other modalities of non-operative treatment for an average period of three and a half months from the onset of symptom. About 44% of these patients achieved significant pain relief and rapidly returned to their sporting activity. Another study of 17 National Football League athletes with 27 distinct lumbar disc herniations proven on the MRI. They received total 37 lumbar epidural steroid injections. So some of them had more than one injection. The procedures were performed at an average period of 4 days from the onset of symptoms, so quite early compared to normal pain population that I will see in the pain clinic, which will be several years down the symptoms. These players were able to return to the sporting activity 24 times, so out of 27 distinct episodes of lumbar disc herniation. So 90% returned to sporting activity rate. 4 patients required repeat injections for the same episode, of which 3 eventually required surgery over time. What was associated with poor outcome was the sequestrated disc and neurological deficit, and we know that that is the truth, that patients who got sequestrated disc and weakness generally do not do very well with any kind of injections, nerve root blocks or epidurals that we perform. Degenerative disc disease in the absence of any sciatica, just causing axial back pain, non-surgical management is the mainstay of treatment. Some of these patients, along with their degenerative disc disease, will have facet joint related problems. And in those patients, you can consider facet joint interventions. But without facet joint degeneration, a lot of young athletes are also prone for facet joint synovitis, especially at the lower lumbar levels, L4-5, L5-S1. Athletes who are involved in repetitive extension and torsion of the lumbar spine, specifically golfers, throwers, encounter facet joint related pain. A prospective study of 12 baseball pitchers with bilateral L4, L5 facet joint synovitis who underwent diagnostic middle branch block followed by radiofrequency neurotomy of bilateral L4, L5S1 facet joint had significant improvement in their pain scores, as well as 83% of them returned to sporting activity at their pre-injury level. And this was continued, their improvement continued at the follow-up period of 1 year. Now, these guys did not respond to intra-articular facet joint injections with local anesthetic and steroid. I omitted that line. So when they did not respond to that, they had the diagnostic middle branch block followed by radiofrequency for longer term relief. There are some patients who have spondylysis and spondylolisthesis. About half of 50% of the low back pain in athletes is attributed to this problem. I don't need to explain you this about what is the difference between spondylosis and spondylolisthesis, but acute symptomatic past defects are managed initially with activity modification, braces, rest, and physical therapy. Early diagnosis, short rest period is the key factor in managing their pain as well as their early return to sporting activity. We can consider injection of the past fractures, especially when they got bone edema on their MRI in on investigations. So these are a group of 121 patients undergoing past injections. VAS scores were used to measure the outcomes. 92% patients who had fluoroscopically guided injections were technically successful, resulting in statistically significant pain reduction immediately post-injection and 1 week post-injection. There isn't much literature on the evidence for past injection for the treatment of symptomatic spondylosis, but it appears to be an attractive option, and it is an alternative short-term management for chronic past-related pain in athletes and getting them back to their sporting activity. Now, there are a couple of things that we need to be considerate when we are treating these athletes. We do not need to demonize necessary sporting activities. The athletes need to be very cautious before blaming high activity levels or one particular form of exercise for the onset or deterioration of low back pain. While a sudden increase in a bowling load is associated with increased risk of pain or injury in cricketers, a high chronic bowling load is actually associated with lower risk. Even when a specific activity is linked to the onset of low back pain, we need to be mindful not to induce a long-term reluctance among these athletes to expose their body appropriately to high load due to sense of vulnerability. While specific proactive tasks might be avoided or reduced in the short term, there is good evidence that exercising with some pain is at least as effective as pain-free rehabilitation. do not say the rehabilitation exercise as a correcting vulnerability. Certain types of exercises are often pitched as being particularly protective for the spine, despite of evidence that most forms of exercises help the low back pain to some extent. Promoting whatever exercises that are prescribed as making the athletes even more robust and resilient may reduce the vulnerability for further injuries and improve their physical and psychological readiness. Keep them as active as possible. Closely monitor their low back pain, how their back pain responds depending on their activity, their workload. Even if certain activities are painful and must be limited, maintaining some form of activity is important rather than keeping them completely sedentary. Athletes with bone marrow edema in the region of pars interarticularis might be provoked by specific tasks and movements such as running or spinal extension. They can avoid that for time being. But if the pain is not getting worse, then there is no reason for refraining from those kind of exercises. Avoiding advocating complete rest and using bracing in such situation could increase the risk of athlete becoming chronic rehab a person. There is a risk of poor performance and recurrent pain or injury because they will get deconditioned very, very quickly. Pain-free cross-training such as high-intensity static bicycle intervals is often possible, which can maintain fitness and facilitate early return to sport in this population. Specific aspect of skill or conditioning need of development can also be targeted during these periods. Do not ignore non-physical factors, and the psychological factors are important just like any other. You've seen the English cricket team turning around after the psychologist, the team psychologist intervened, and that happens in every sport at every opportunity. What about some recurrent hamstring muscle injury or tightness? People, you know, rugby players, football players, and some cricketers that I have come across do complain. They have no pathology in their spine, but they just got recurrent hamstring tightness. They get pain in the L5-S1 distribution, and they have absolutely normal MRIs. They have no abnormality of their piriformis muscle when the MRI of their pelvis is done. And I have been asked on a number of occasions by the team physios and the team physicians to do epidural steroids, either in the form of a caudal epidural or doing a transforaminal L5 nerve root injection on the site of injury. And I have seen these patients, well, these athletes, returning to their activities, their sporting, their football game next day or day after within 48 hours. I have no explanation on how it works. Maybe some people who are more experienced than me can tell me. But it certainly, I've seen it making a difference. I won't name the people, but I've seen them playing on the field next day or after 48 hours after doing these injections. NHS will never commission this. Okay. Sacroiliac joint dysfunction. Again, there are two schools of thoughts. Some do not believe in sacroiliac joint dysfunction or sacroiliac joint related pain at all. I do. Exact prevalence among athletes is unknown. Referral pattern is similar to spinal problems. You know, they will have low back pain relating into their buttocks, at the back of their thigh, sometimes as far down as their ankle, but they don't have any paresthesia, they don't have any radicular symptoms, they do not have any neurogenic claudication. About 40% of patients with SIJ dysfunction will have some concomitant spinal pathology, degenerative disc disease, facet joint related changes, etc. It is postulated that up to a third of low back pain can originate from sacroiliac joint. Diagnosis can be challenging due to the complexity of the sacroiliac joint as well as the innervation and the referral pattern of the pain in these athletes. Tenderness in the sacroiliac sulcus is highly sensitive but not specific. There are various tests and we can spend a whole day debating about their sensitivity, specificity, etc. But they are adjunct to symptoms, clinical examination, and ultimately, if it all marries, then you can't do sacroiliac joint injection when there is a diagnosis in question. If somebody gets almost near complete pain relief with a sacroiliac joint injection, then you can at least say that their pain is coming from the sacroiliac joint. And then they can engage with rehabilitation techniques. You can do intra-articular, peri-articular injection of steroids. My normal recipe is I use 80 milligrams of triamcinolone if it is unilateral, 40 milligrams on each side if I'm doing bilateral sacroiliac joint injection, which is very rare, except when patients had a previous spinal fusion. Otherwise, generally, I come across more with unilateral sacroiliac joint pain. I use 0.5% to 0.75% levobupivacaine, and volume is, my volume is 4 ml. Some people believe in lower volume. There is no consensus on dosing preference. You can use any steroid. I have given you my steroid, my choice of steroid. Other painful condition, osteoarthritis pubis. Again, not very common. It is an inflammatory condition caused by chronic repetitive microtrauma with the pubic symphysis. Pain will be, I mean, it is prevalent in kicking sports such as soccer and is often associated with either adductor dysfunction or rectus abdominis injury. They typically have pain starting in the pubic symphysis, radiating into their groin, and sometimes little radiation into the scrotal area as well. Commonly confused with sporting hernias, but which is one of the differential diagnoses. Symptoms, well, we covered that last paragraph. Investigations, you can do plain radiographs of the pubic symphysis, which can sometimes show subchondral irregularities, sclerosis, osseous erosion, and widening of the pubic symphysis. If there is discrepancy of more than 2 millimeter between the inferior pubic margins, you can confirm symphysial instability on a stress radiography. You can get MRI, and it can show some T2 signal changes in the form of marrow edema. In chronic patients, there could be presence of subchondral cyst, erosions, or articular surface irregularities and widening of the joint on their MRI. Stress fractures can common, they can occur, and if they are there, they need to be recognized and managed appropriately. You can also do radionucleotide scans and just see the bone edema in these patients. The treatment is similar, you know, rest, rehabilitation, anti-inflammatories. If that doesn't settle them down, you can do image-guided injection of local anesthetic and steroid into that area. If you try to treat them in their acute phase, you get much better outcomes with injections than once the pain has become chronic because of the anatomical changes that you will get in that area. Surgical management is reserved for patients who fail to respond to non-surgical treatment. So that was about the injection therapy. Now just last 5 minutes on the analgesics, analgesic management. And there is actually a big systematic review that was published last year about analgesic management in athletes. And because these athletes, when they got private insurance, they got access to team physios, team physicians, their own doctors, they have multiple sources from where they can get their medications. And the same is true for injections, you know. And it is important that when we see them, we take good history of what they have taken, where they have obtained those medications from, so that we're not overdosing them with the same class of medication. They can use medication in oral, injectable, transdermal, non-steroidal anti-inflammatories. They can take paracetamol, opioids, injectable and transdermal anesthetics, as well as cannabinoids, antidepressants, anxiolytics, muscle relaxants, anticonvulsants. There is a huge range of medications that patients can take. It is important that efforts to prevent or manage pain solely based with medication can increase the risk of adverse effects while failing to resolve the underlying pain condition. So again, that is where the multidisciplinary input from the physio, the team psychologist, and the physicians comes into picture. In addition to some substances used for pain are listed on the anti-doping agency website, which is updated on a yearly basis, and it is important that we adhere to those. And before we suggest any medication, we need to explain the implications of that and discuss that with the team, physio, coach, etc. That is the list that is published in January 2019. But the drugs that we will use for pain, almost of them are there on that list. I was quite surprised not to find tramadol on that list. I don't know why. But most of the narcotics like buprenorphine, diamorphine, fentanyl, hydromorphone, methadone, morphine, oxycodone, oxymorphone, pentazocine, and pethidine are there. The steroids that we inject or administered orally, intramuscularly, all of them are listed where these drugs are prohibited when the athlete is in competition. Well, cannabinoids, natural cannabinoids are prohibited, as is the synthetic cannabinoid. So everything that is prescribed will be prohibited. Cannabidol, which is the CBD oil, which does not have any analgesic properties, is not on the prohibited list. So that is the, I don't prescribe it, I don't recommend it, but just for information that it is there. What about studies assessing the effectiveness of analgesics? So there are 8 randomized controlled trials, and I've only taken randomized controlled trials about anti-inflammatory. So flubiprofen was more efficacious than aspirin in terms of pain reduction, return to play related to acute lower limb soft tissue injuries. Paroxicam was more efficacious than tenoxicam and naproxen in reducing pain from acute sporting related ligament sprain. Paroxicam was also shown to be more efficacious than ibuprofen in reducing acute pain and increasing active and passive physical function in athletes with sprains, strains, and other soft tissue injuries that could have caused functional disability. English professional football players, club doctors, and club physiotherapists all described enormous pressure to avoid and missing match due to injury. We have seen in previous presentations how well paid some of the athletes are. It is important that they need to return to their games as soon as possible. The injectable analgesic use was related to the guilt over missing the matches. There is no evidence that injectable non-steroidal is any better than oral non-steroidal, and same thing about rectal. The side effect profile is exactly same, and it is a myth that if you give rectal non-steroidal, they have less gastric irritation as compared to injectable or oral. It's a myth because the mechanism is completely different. But you know, because of their urgency of returning to their sporting activities, sometimes these athletes are exposed to parenteral use of medication. Non-steroidals still are the most common used medication among elite athletes. About 30 to 50% of athletes will take oral non-steroidals during their tournaments. These rates are much lower than the estimates of other pain medications, including oral analgesics, injectable NSAIDs, anesthetics, and corticosteroids. And studies in general population and non-elite athletes have identifiable health risks related to non-steroidal use. And I think that is where that may be because they do not get as much professional input as compared to the athletes. So even though the athletes use them more commonly, they use in a prescribed manner. So in summary, with treating these professional athletes is really satisfying for me as a pain doctor because they get better. They have motivation to get better. I get to see them much earlier in their injury and pain cycle as opposed to 7 years, which is an average for an NHS patient from onset of their pain to being presented in the pain clinic. It is very important that there is a close liaison with team physician, physiotherapist, player, plus minus coach, and a team psychologist. And without that communication, you cannot really make justice and you cannot function. It is demanding talking to all these people. I had to do a lot more work to get it going, but it is still satisfying. You need to understand the mechanism of injury in order to decide how you're going to treat these patients. Detailed history of current and previous interventions. Yes, some of these professional footballers, they are on several million pounds a year contract. I asked them, okay, what did you have injected? Oh, my coach sent me to Leeds. I went to the radiology suite. I had injection and that's it. How long ago it was? Maybe 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago. But that is the problem. That is where you need to speak to the team physio, team physician, to know exactly what they had done. Awareness about the banned substances and time constraints. You get a phone call, you know, we need injection today. He's supposed to play tomorrow, he's supposed to play over the weekend. A typical phone call on a Thursday evening, can you do the injection? And there is a lot of organization that is required in order to meet their demands. And that's it. I'll stop there. Thank you.